So I'll start with a quick intro. I travel a lot, and one of the things that happens when you travel is you come to a new country, and they ask you what your occupation is. And I never feel very comfortable to say that I'm an artist. And what I want to say is that I'm a researcher, because I will make the argument that artistic practice is a form of research. So the same way a company would have an R&D department, that artists are a kind of R&D department for humanity, that artists are thinking of possible futures. So I'm going to show you a little bit about my research and what I do, and then I'm going to end by talking about this project, the iWriter. So I write software. I'm a kind of heavy geek, heavy nerd. And so what I'm going to talk to you today is really about drawing and code. But this is a tool where when you make a drawing, you draw a line, the line actually uncurls itself. So the curvature of the line is kind of programming the animation. And it's a kind of what-if question. And all of the things that I do are really like a kind of, they're really what-if questions. So I'm working on different drawing tools. This is a collaboration called Rhonda, which is a 3D drawing tool, which is really a similar kind of what-if question. You know, what if drawing, like we draw in our sketchbook, but drawing in 3D was just as simple? So here, you know, traditional 3D software has this really complicated interfaces, and we have no interface, that it's just sketching, but you're sketching in 3D. And it's this kind of tools that we do, and we build these tools, and then people use them in all kinds of creative ways, you know, just kind of sketching and playing, and it's really, the thing that I love about it is kind of this process of building things for people. I'll walk you through a few projects so you can see where I'm coming from. This is a project called Drawn. This is began as a performance, and the idea is that I would be on stage and live painting, and the audience would see what I was painting behind me. So it was a kind of, in a way, a sort of magic trick. It was inspired by the work of Thomas Edison and John Stuart Blackton from 1905, called The Enchanted Drawing. And here, they use film techniques to create the illusion of a drawing leaving the paper. Also inspired by the work of the Portuguese artist Helena Almeida, who would take black and white photographs and add blue paint. So here, she paints a blue dot, she picks it up, she eats it, and she cries blue tears. And for me, there's something really beautiful about this idea of paint as something you could touch. So I created this performance where I would be on stage live painting, and I worked with this Japanese musician, Parden Kimura. So short clip.
続いてご紹介するのはザッカリーさんの作品ドローン。ザッカリーさん、白い紙に何やら書いていますが、あらら、動き始めましたよ。
And so the idea is that I would paint something and then I could touch what I'd painted. It would kind of come to life. And so we were touring in Japan, and what was amazing is that after every performance, the audience would come up, they would want to try it. So decided to make a version for people to try themselves. So this is an installation where you can come and paint and then, you know, interact with what you've painted. There was something that I noticed when I watched people play with this installation, which I coined the open mouth phenomenon. I got really excited about the idea of an open mouth. So I want you to pay attention to this girl. This is in a festival for children called Cinekid in Amsterdam. So this is number one. Number two, you can see the finger kind of entering the scene. Number three and number four. This open mouth, so my friend Evan Roth, who I'll talk about in a second, he calls this the holy fuck moment. I call it the open mouth moment, but I think we're talking about the same thing. And I would make the argument that as an aesthetic strategy, an open mouth is a pathway to somebody's heart. So one more project, and then I'll talk about the iWriter. This is kind of, again, on the realm of drawing. This is a project called IQ Font, and really was a kind of advertisement for the Toyota IQ car, which is one of these small smart cars. And you know, people believe that you can't drive them, you can't really make sharp turns, or the car's going to fall over, or you can't really speed it. And the idea we had was to make a typeface. So it was a collaboration between myself and a stunt driver and two typographers, and we created a typeface completely driven by the stunt driver and by the car. So we designed this typeface, and then I wrote software that tracks the car from above, and we created a font that you can actually download and install and use. And all of the letter forms are completely created by driving. So here you can see the software in action. And the driver is really crazy. He had a lot of fun. What's amazing is that he wipes out, so he's making these sharp turns, and they become part of the letter forms. Even to the point, I mean, he was really a badass. There was one point where he drove this G backwards. This is the G backwards. That's ridiculous. So the last project I want to talk about is a project that's really dear to my heart, which is a project called the iWriter. And this is really a collaboration between myself and Theo Watson and Chris Agru. The three of us work on this project called OpenFrameworks, which is a toolkit for artists. We take the things that we learn in making art, and we make tools for other artists to make projects. And also with the members of the Graffiti Research Lab, Evan Roth, who I mentioned about the holy fuck moment, and James Potterly. And they're really looking at the intersection of graffiti and technology and building new forms and new ways to approach graffiti. And it's a collaboration between the five of us and Tempt. Tempt is a old school LA graffiti writer and artist and activist who has Lou Gehrig's disease, ALS. So about 7 years ago, he was walking down the street and fell over, and he was diagnosed with ALS, and now he has advanced stage ALS, meaning he's completely paralyzed, and he uses a ventilator. I mean, he's on a machine that helps him breathe. And so we went out to LA to meet him. We were invited by a company, the Ebling Group, that brought us out to LA. And we got to know Tony, we got to know his background. We got to meet his caregivers, his family, and just kind of understand his, what his life is like now. And, you know, he has a commercial eye tracker. So here he says, dude, my hardware is ghetto. But he could be saying, you know, dude, my hardware is expensive. These eye trackers are $15,000, $20,000. And there was a period of time when he didn't have, you know, he didn't have it. And the way he would communicate was a piece of paper. And somebody would take their finger on the piece of paper, on the alphabet, and really, spell out the words. And so what we decided to do is really kind of get to know him and get to know his condition.
My son, Tony.
This is a video that's narrated by Tony's father.
Is there because he suffered from Lou Gehrig's disease. He's in an advanced stage of Lou Gehrig's disease, otherwise referred to as ALS. He is not able to move. His limbs, or eat, or talk, or move any part of his body, however, his brain is wide awake, and he just full of ideas and creativity, and it's fortunate that you guys have introduced him to life at this point in time.
So what we've been doing is developing low-cost hardware, low-cost software, related to eye tracking. So we've been learning about how to make eye trackers. We've also been designing software for Tony's system so that he can draw with the system that he has, so we could go back and forth between our system and his system. And finally, we've come up with developing a $50 eye tracker, which is you can build really with off-the-shelf components, and we published the source code and the hardware for making this eye tracker. And so it's this thing we call the iWriter. Here you can see our development. The lower left corner is the Kanye eye tracker that didn't work very well. But the basic idea is using glasses and a webcam and writing software that's really about eye tracking. Here's a kind of demo of it. In addition, we were looking at Tony's love of letter forms and trying to make software that really would allow him to express himself again. So looking at his artwork and trying to weave that into the software. So here's Tony kind of wearing our system. And in order to draw with the system, he uses his eye to plot points. And from points, he makes lines. And from lines, he makes letters. And from letters, words. And as soon as we had a system where Tony could draw, we were thinking, you know, what is the next step? And the next step for us was to actually go out on the streets of LA and project Tony's drawings. So Tony would be in the hospital room drawing, and we would go out on the street and project what he was drawing, and then actually stream it back into the hospital. So Tony would be in his hospital room drawing and then see his drawings on the side of a building.
By just moving his eyes.
So here's kind of primitive version of the software. You can see an E, and then an M,
right there in his room,
and a P,
or right there,
and a T.
In public. Just last night, we were out in downtown Los Angeles, dark corners of downtown Los Angeles. And as I stood there in some dark corner, fearing for my luck, up there in the tall building. Unbelievable, someone was tagging Tim's name up there. That was actually Tony drawing in his hospital room. And miles away, it was being projected onto the wall of the building. It was happened to be ironically next to a freeway, so the people that were driving by were able to enjoy this as well. But the idea that that was actually taking place was unbelievable.
They can't comprehend, or even come close to understanding him. I guess if I was born, they would love me more. Guess if I was simple in the mind, everything would be fine. Maybe if I was a jerk to girls, instead of being nice and speaking kind words, so then maybe it would be okay to say then I wasn't a good guy to begin with. But my mind is all crazy, 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 crazy. They got me thinking I ain't human, like I came from above, 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 above.
Tony said, that was the first time I've drawn anything since 2003. It feels like taking a breath after being held underwater for 5 minutes. And he's continuing to draw. He's continuing to draw, and he's really hacking our software and pushing it in ways we had never expected. All of his drawings are saved online, and we've had collaborations with other artists, like this is in Norway, where graffiti artists in Norway have painted Tony's tags. We've even, an artist in Pittsburgh hooked it up to a robotic arm. So here, short clip.
Whoa, oh, it's pushing really too hard.
Here. So this is our dream. For the future. And this semester I've been teaching a course at Parsons School of Design where my students have been looking at the future version. So we actually have a 2.0 version of the iWriter that we're gonna publish very soon, which doesn't use glasses, but it is also kind of low cost, do-it-yourself and easy to build eye tracker. The last slide I'll show about this project, and I have one more slide. This is a kid who we were out in LA building it, and this is the son of the couple that invited us to come out. And he's built his own version of the iWriter. And the reason I love this image is just it suggests the power of art to inspire the next generation, and even just the power of individuals. You know, there are problems that exist in the world that governments are not going to solve and companies are not going to solve, but individuals and collectives will be able to solve. The last image I'll end the talk with, these are two kids. This is my favorite image of all the images of the work. These are two kids that have come to the Drawn installation. This is the one with painting and ink. And the reason I love this image is it's really clear to see on their expression this sense of wonder. And I had set the exhibit up in Japan, and this grandmother grabbed my hand at the end of the, you know, the end of the opening, and she, in this very broken English, she said, "You're giving the children good dreams." And I think that's what we have the power to do, is give the children good dreams. Thank you.